Hello everyone and welcome. In this video we're going to be talking about how Tesla hit 60 miles per hour in just 2.28 seconds. Now this video was inspired actually by a Reddit thread. Someone posted that Motor Trend had tested out the new Tesla P100D and they broke their record. The first car they've ever tested getting under 2.3 seconds 0 to 60 time. But then there was a lot of discussion of what if we put this package into a Tesla Roadster, would it be faster or would it be slower because the Roadster weighs less. And so there was a lot of confusion in this discussion thread about grip. So in order to get a really fast 0 to 60 time, you really need three things. You need a ton of power. The Tesla P100D has 680 horsepower, so it's got plenty of power. You need all-wheel drive so that you can put all of that power to the ground. Model S P100D has all-wheel drive. And you need grip. And grip is the one that confuses people, and so that's what we're going to kind of get into here. Now, if you've watched my video on what is the fastest 0 to 60 time possible, you'll recall that the logic I use is looking at the braking distance of vehicles in order to determine what's the fastest 0 to 60 time possible using street tires, not race tires, street legal tires. And so using that logic, you look at the braking of a vehicle because that's using its maximum amount of grip possible. The ABS motors kick in if there's slip in order to allow it to rotate further and not just slide. And so you're going to be hitting the edge of the grip of those tires and you're going to be decelerating as fast as possible. So the reverse logic is if you can decelerate that fast, if you have enough power, which this car does, it's got plenty of horsepower, then you can accelerate at that same rate. And so that grip limit, as discussed in that video, if you want the derivation for these equations, you might want to check that out. But distance equals 1/2 velocity squared divided by acceleration. The distance that Motor Trend was able to stop with a P85D was 102 feet. The P100D, they stopped in 109 feet, but I'm going to go with this one because it's the most extreme and it's the theoretical limit of this Tesla Model S. That's the best test they've ever had, and this is also the best acceleration test they've ever had, so I'm going to compare those two to each other. So 102, oh, and you're going to be angry about units. I already know that. Apologies. These are units straight from Motor Trend. Maybe write them a letter and tell them to switch their magazine to metric units if you don't like that. Anyways, these are the units that they use, so I'm going to continue to use them. 102 equals 1/2 88 squared. 88 is feet per second. That's 60 miles per hour converted to feet per second. So 88 feet per second equals 60 miles per hour divided by A. We solve for A. A gives us 37.9 feet per second squared, 0.96 feet per second squared. So this number, if you divide that by 32.2, that's the acceleration of gravity on planet Earth, that gives you 1.18 Gs. So this car is able to decelerate based on a stopping distance of 102 feet at 1.18 Gs. So I would assume it would also be able to accelerate if it had enough power based on the grip of the tires. So velocity equals acceleration times time. We take 88 feet per second, divide that by 37.96, and that gives us a 0 to 60 of 2.32 seconds. 2.32 seconds, as you will notice, is very close to Motor Trend's 2.28 seconds. So I'm saying theoretical limit based on braking is 2.32. They actually beat that with a 2.28. Regardless, they are very close. But there are a couple things to keep in mind about why this number could theoretically be better than this number. First of all, the Model S P100D has larger rear tires. So when you have load transfer to those rear tires, they will have more grip versus when you're braking, you have skinnier tires up front, which are handling more load. And so that's going to be one small difference. Now it's a small difference. I think it's only 20 millimeters wider in the rear, but once again, this is a very small difference as well, 2.28 versus 2.32. The other thing to keep in mind is that it has a 51-49 weight distribution, according to Motor Trend, the vehicle they tested. So that means more weight in the front. So what this means is when you're braking, you're going to have relatively more load on the front tires than when you're accelerating because that center of gravity is closer to those front tires. So under braking, the front tire has more load than the rear tire, relatively more speaking than how much the rear tire has under accelerating versus the front tire. What that means is the weight distribution is more even under acceleration than it is under braking. And a more even weight distribution under acceleration means you'll have slightly more traction in order to accelerate faster. And that can help explain how they got 2.28 versus 2.32. Okay, so that's how Tesla did it. Really, it's just power, grip, and all-wheel drive. But all the confusion came from this question right here in this Reddit thread where they said, you know, what if they put this package in a Tesla Roadster? How quick would that thing be? Would it actually be faster? And there were two kind of conflicting arguments here. Some people would say, yes, it's lighter, therefore it would be quicker. And then other people would say, no, because the Model S has more weight, it has more traction. And so I think a lot of that confusion comes from this book, Carol Smith's Tune to Win, which is actually a fantastic book. And within it, there are two graphs which are actually pretty helpful to look at. The first one, coefficient of friction versus vertical tire load. And you can see that as the tire load on a vehicle increases, the coefficient of friction of that tire with the ground decreases. So what this is saying is that as you increase weight, you're decreasing the amount of grip that that tire has. However, there is also a graph in this book that shows that as you increase vertical load on the tire, the amount of force that the tire can apply to the ground increases. So traction is increasing with an increase in vertical load. Now, the sentence that Smith says in this book, which I think confuses a lot of people, is he says, the curve is so gentle that the increase in vertical load overpowers the decrease in coefficient. And so if you're looking at this graph here, the vertical load increases and the amount of traction that the tire has increases, even though your coefficient of friction is going down. So, applying that to our question here, would a Roadster be quicker? Well, there's some very simple math which we can do in order to prove if it's yes or no to that question. So looking at his exact chart and just pulling some data points from it, if we look at a 1,000-pound car, we can read that it has a coefficient of friction with just 250 pounds per tire of 1.45. If we look at a 5,000-pound car, we can see that it has 1,250 pounds per tire for a coefficient of friction of 1.1. Now, if we look at the equation for the maximum force that the tire can apply to the ground, that's going to be equal to the coefficient of friction multiplied by the normal force. In this case, 1.45 times 1,000. This will give us 1,450 pounds force. That's the maximum force, assuming the car has enough horsepower for it, that it can apply to the ground without the tire spinning. So, F equals ma, 1450 divided by 1,000 pounds mass. We're just calculating the acceleration here. So A equals F divided by m. There's our force, there's our mass. That gives us 1.45 g's. If we do the same for our 5,000 pound car, assuming it has plenty of horsepower and can take care of that end of it, we're going to do 5,000 times 1.1. That's going to give us 5,500 pounds force. 5,500 pounds force divided by 5,000 pounds mass is going to give us 1.1 g's. You'll notice this correlates perfectly with the coefficient of friction. So how fast will you get to 60 using an acceleration of 1.45 g's? You take 88, you divide that by 1.45 times 32.2. That's gravity in feet per second squared on planet Earth at sea level. And that is going to give us 1.88 seconds. You do the same for 1.1 g's, and that's going to give you 2.48 seconds. And so you can see there's a 0.6 difference here in time purely from weight. So both of these cars have infinite power. The only thing holding them back is grip. And you can see that because this car weighs 4,000 pounds less, its coefficient of friction is higher, and therefore it is able to accelerate faster. So yes, a Tesla Roadster fitted with a P100D, assuming it could keep its weight less than the P100D Model S, would be faster to 60 because the coefficient of friction would be lower. Something that this graph here doesn't show you is that acceleration would be constant. It would just be a linear line coming out like that. Not a very linear line, but you get the idea. It would just be a straight line coming out, and because of this coefficient of friction is decreasing, that tire force is decreasing as well. And so normally, if both of these cars had the exact same tires and the exact same coefficient of friction and the same and infinite power, they would both accelerate at this exact same rate. So, you know, the equation here really just comes from F equals ma. So acceleration equals force divided by mass. As you increase mass, the force does not increase as much. So that would be this line here, but instead it's less. The tire force is less. And so you're having an equation where this number is getting slightly smaller relative to this number, which means your acceleration is getting smaller. So you cannot add mass to a system like this and have it accelerate faster. There are scenarios in which adding mass can increase how quickly you accelerate, but that tends to be with two-wheel drive setups, and I do have a video explaining that. Now, I think a big part of the confusion of all of this is something called tire load sensitivity, and it's one of my much less viewed videos that I would highly recommend checking out, purely because it helps explain why this coefficient of friction drops and why heavier cars are going to have less traction and be able to accelerate more slowly. It also explains why wider tires give you more grip. Also, I will include a link in the video description to Carol Smith's book. If you're interested in this kind of stuff, it's a fantastic book for learning more about this material. So thank you guys for watching. Thank you to whoever, pulled me in on the comment thread there on Reddit. And if you guys have any questions or comments, feel free to leave them below.